that you stand to your feet. And let us turn to the Word of God, to the book of Acts. And we'll turn to the 16th chapter. And we'll see something happen right around verse 25. And we shall find these words. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake. And so the foundation of the prison were shaken. And immediately, all the doors were open. And everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. You may be seated. Do we have any guests that are visiting with us for the very first time? And if so, we would ask that not only that you raise your hands, but would you just stand so we can see where you are? Because we have something special that we'd like to do.
Amen.
Amen. New season, let's make them feel welcome.
It's a new day and new season. God's making God is the reason. Welcome to this hour of worship. Welcome to this house of praise. We worship Him in our love. We worship Him in our pride. We want you to worship.
we thank you for the offerings that are being given today. Lord, bless this, use it, multiply it, and let your kingdom be greatly built. We praise you and thank you now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome to New Season Ministry, where we believe in teaching the Word of God, preaching the will of God, and reaching a walk with God. We are excited that you're here to worship with us today. We pray that this will be a great experience for you and that you will come back next week and bring a friend.
Today is Sunday, November 8th, and my name is Desiree.
And my name is Hope.
All ministry leaders, and you know who you are, your 2016 calendar events need to be provided to Sister Felicia Sexton before the next leadership meeting, which is on November 18th. That's 10 days from today. So if you have any questions, make sure you contact Sister Felicia Sexton.
There are many opportunities at New Season to praise the Lord in song. We have our choir practice for the children of Judah on Tuesdays from 5:30 p.m. until 6:30 p.m. All children ages 3 to 12 are welcome. The men's choir practice will be Wednesday, November 11th, which is Veterans Day, at 7:30 p.m. All men are invited to join.
For more information, see Minister Ken Smalls or Brother Ray Nix. The mass choir practice, that's mass, will be on Thursday, November 19th at 6 p.m., and everyone is invited to participate in this choir, including children. If you have any questions, contact Dr. Shanita Shine-Turner or Sister Cynthia Smalls.
Have you ever considered becoming a part of the men's ministry or the women's ministry? They both provide opportunities to connect on a more personal level with other believers, share experiences, pray together, and study the Word of God. The men's ministry will meet at the church on Saturday, November 14th at 9:30 a.m. The men will be discussing events for the upcoming year. For more information, please see Minister Ken Smalls.
Now, the women's ministry will have their monthly fellowship on Saturday, November 21st at 9:30 a.m. So ladies, come out and bring a friend so we can rejoice in the Lord together. If you have any questions on this event, please contact Sister Karen Robinson.
Lights! Would you like to be up here where we're giving the morning announcements, or maybe working behind the scenes, filming or writing the scripts? Then we want Y-O-U. And we need you for the video ministry. We meet every Tuesday at 5:30 p.m. to tape. If you're interested in joining us, contact any one of our video team members.
Now praise God from whom all blessings flow. On Thanksgiving Day, we will give honor and glory to God for who He is and everything that He has done and continues to do for us. Thanksgiving worship service is on Thanksgiving Day, November 26th at 9 a.m.
After describing how the Samaritan rescued a hurting man whom others had passed by in Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 30 through 37, Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." Following Christ's command, the Samaritan Purse Program has provided aid to the world sick, poor, and suffering in the name of Christ.
For their Samaritan Purse Program this year, the ushers are asking for your donations to provide sustainable resources such as baby chickens, clean water, and dairy animals to those in need. The last day to donate is November 30th. Sign-up sheets are going to be located at the guest services desk, and the point of contact for this activity is Sister Karen Robinson.
Finally, if you have announcements, please contact Deaconess Marcia Percy or a member of our video team and let us know. We tape on Tuesdays, so complete an announcement request form and turn it in no later than 1 p.m. on Sunday.
Now, that was a mouthful, but for our guests, visitors, and friends, welcome, and we hope that you will come back and worship with us. You can find more information about us on our Twitter account at New Season, MNSTRY, our YouTube page at NSM4925, just like the address, and of course our official church website, www.newseasonministry.org.
Your morning glory wisdom for this week is, be the rainbow in somebody else's cloud.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, praise the Lord. I'm here to talk a little. I got another announcement that I need to make today. It's a very important announcement. You know, God has been very, very good to us, and He has blessed us with a new facility. Amen.
Yeah.
How many of you were here when we moved from the Fairborn location to this location? Raise your hand. Okay, so there's a lot of us. We understand what it takes to move. Amen.
Yeah.
And we need everybody's help to move. And, you know, what does it say? Many hands make light what?
Word.
Light work. Amen, amen. So our target date for to move into our new facility is the 10th of January, all right? So we want to have our first service there, the 10th of January. So we're looking for volunteers to help us. We've got a lot to do, but, you know, we can get there. We moved here, and God's blessing us. We're going to be able to move there, but we need your help. Dee Dee here. Dee Dee, would you stand up? Dee Dee is also helping with the move, and she's got a sign-up sheet that we'll have outside near the guest service desk. So please sign up. And also, I mean, no matter what, I mean, if you can help with getting some boxes for us, you know, start looking around for boxes as we pack up here to move there. We've got some things to do over there to get it ready to move in. So the ministry leads, please start taking a look at your items, all right? We're going to have a couple days where we're going to take a look at a schedule where we're going to get rid of all the stuff that we're going to throw away and not take with us and start packing up those things that we're not going to be using. So our last service here will be the 3rd of January. And then the first service there would be the 10th of January. So that's our target date. So with your help, we can get there. Okay?
Amen.
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 Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
it stand. And let the world know what it is that we believe. I believe that the Bible of God so needs for my perfect provision.
Therefore, I will seek clear understanding of His Word, proper navigation through His Word, and I will share His plan of salvation with the lost. I will open His Word expectantly, study it prayerfully, and obey it completely. I will order my life according to His commands, His principles, and His precepts.
This is my Bible.
First, Pastor and Lady Deborah are not here this morning, as you can probably tell or have noticed. They're in Detroit this morning. Pastor is ministering there at a special occasion, so we just want to keep them lifted up. Amen. As they're serving there, while they're keeping us lifted up, as we're back here on the home front. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And then to the guests that are here this morning, can I just have you wave your hand at me, because I was not in the sanctuary when, amen, when we acknowledge the guests. Amen. This is our guest. Friends of ours that have come. Good morning, y'all. Amen. Good to see you all this morning as well. God bless you. Thank you for worshiping with us. On behalf of Pastor Johnson, who's not here this morning, we just want to welcome you to New Season Ministry. Amen. And above all, when you leave today, we want you to know that this is a place where we teach the Word of God. Amen. We preach the will of God, and we're all striving to live and to reach a walk with God. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. No one in the midst of you this morning is perfect. We don't claim to be. We just claim to be souls that God has revealed himself to. And we're all on the journey to get closer to him day by day. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Let's go ahead and dismiss our children this morning and for children's church. And while they're doing that, I wonder if you can help me with this here. I need the old, I need. To be independent of one another and anything else in our lives. And so I just think that it's important that we are able to stop and just say to God, I need you. I can't do this thing called life all by myself. I need your direction. I need your guidance. I need some understanding. I just don't even know what I'm doing right now. And where the rest of the world would look at you and just say that you're weak or you don't understand or you're putting your faith in some God as a crutch, I want you to know this morning that it is our cry unto God that I need you that begins to get him activated in your situations.
Amen.
So this morning, I just want you to sing that again. If you're going through something and you really know that you need God to help you go get through what you're going through, I just want you to sing it this morning, to cry it out like the saints of old used to do. Can we do that at least one more time this morning? Amen? I need the old, I need thee, every hour, I need thee, oh, bless me now,
Amen.
Now, thank you for singing it, but I just just sense this morning that some of you are not singing it like you really truly need him. Uh-huh. You're singing it like he's your plan D. Uh-huh. And you're still on plan A. So you don't really need him yet because you have plan B and you can go and try. And then there's a plan C that you can go and try. And then there's a plan D that you can try. But I need you this morning to think back to that last time you had made it all the way to plan D and then you really needed God to come through for you. Do you remember that time in your life? Where you had tried every option, every situation, everything you possibly could. Your money couldn't do it. Your mama couldn't do it. You couldn't figure it out. And so you had to cry out, oh, I need the oh, I need thee. Calling on God. See, sometimes when you call on God, God answers, but the answer is I need something of you as well. And you see, that's where we can also find ourselves getting into some trouble. See, I'm not even preaching yet, y'all. I'm sorry. Not even in my sermon. See, the first hindrance is we don't want to reach out and ask God for the assistance and the help that we need. But then sometimes we do, and God says, here's the answer, and here's what I need of you, and we struggle saying yes to the thing that God has told us to do. So the chorus goes like this, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When the Spirit speaks to me, in my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When the Spirit speaks to me, when my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes.
Church say yes, 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 yes. If you love him, yes.
Say yes, sir. Yeah. God, each one of us, we're living this life the best way that we know how, that we can. But God, we confess this morning that we are in need of you.
Yes.
God, we need your direction. We need your hand. We need your mercy. God, we need your wisdom. We need your understanding, Father. Lord, we are dealing with a variety of things, as you know. Each one is for her own situation. God, our only hope is to hear from you. So God, this morning we cry out to you saying, we need you. We need a word from you, God. We need direction from you, Lord. We need understanding from you, God. We need your touch in our lives, God. And God, as you speak to us today, our confession, our heart says, Lord, that we will say yes to you. Lord, yes to your will. Yes to your way, God. Yes to your word, Father. Yes to what it is you would have us to do and to be. God, we know that your plans for our lives are much greater than our own could ever be. So God, it's with a submitted, humble heart today that we say to you, we need you, and our answer will be yes. God, I pray for Chaplain Johnson this morning. God, I thank you for opening a door of opportunity for him to speak and to be in the ministry where he is today. God, I thank you that Lady Deborah was able to travel with him, Lord, that they made it safely to Detroit, God. Lord, I don't know the hour that he will speak and minister today, but God, I pray that you would be with him and move through him in a mighty way, God. Lord, that as folk leave the church on today, they would know that surely God was in that place. Lord, we pray that you would be with them and guide them as they travel back home, Lord, in the coming days, and allow them to arrive safely again. Father, bless now this hour and this time. I pray, oh God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, Lord, would be acceptable in your sight. Lord, I pray that today someone would hear something and be moved in a way to know more of who you are, to see more of who you are, and to trust you in a deeper and more intimate way. We love you, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That was just a warm-up. Praise God. I believe that God has a word for us today. I really do. Every time I come to God's house, whether I'm preaching or not preaching, I'm just excited about what God wants to do. So this morning, I've chosen for a subject, making sense of your midnight. Making sense of your midnight. As I think about the phrase or the term midnight, it's often used to describe a low point, a dark place, a dark time where we're in search of answers and may not be able to clearly see and understand what's going on. And sometimes it is in that midnight hour that we can give up because we are so overwhelmed. I believe the reality is that each and every one of us either has been, is in, or is heading to a midnight hour. And so as we approach this subject this morning, it's important to understand that the goal of life ought not be to avoid ever having a midnight hour, because your midnight is coming, whether you want it or not. The goal of our time today is to understand that it is what you do in the midnight hour that matters the most. Amen? I'm going to lift up John 16:33. You can turn there if you'd like to. It's one verse. We're really going to spend our time in the book of Acts this morning. But this one verse in John chapter 16:33 says this. Jesus speaking says, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. For in the world you will have trouble," or tribulation, it may say. "But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." In this scripture, Jesus tells us two very important things. The first thing that he says is, in this world you're going to have some trouble. It doesn't matter how good you are. It doesn't matter how straight and narrow you walk. Some kind of way, for some reason, you're going to deal with some stuff in this world. But the second thing that he says there, the back half of that verse says, I want you to, though you have trouble, to be of good cheer, because you need to understand, I have already overcome the world. Right. See, that's important. What he's saying is, You don't have to worry about being overcome by the trouble of this world, because I've already overcome the world and the trouble that's in it. And since I've already overcome the world and the trouble that's in it, if you abide in me, you abide in the overcoming victory that I've already established and is available to you. So the goal ought not be that I focus on the trouble, the tribulation, the difficulty, the trials that I'm going through down here in this world. I need to, in spite of focusing on the trials, always remember back that Jesus has already overcome those trials. That's the first thing we have to understand. The second thing is another familiar scripture found in the book of Proverbs at chapter 3. I'm just going to read four verses, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Many of you may be able to quote these or some of these by memory. It says this: trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. It says, do not be wise in your own eyes, but fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. See, this is an important thought, because oftentimes when we face trouble in this world, thank you, sir, our default response is to begin trusting in our own understanding. I begin to try to figure out what exactly is going on in this situation. And not just what's going on in this situation, I always also begin to try to figure out what I need to do about it. How can I fix it? How can I change it? How can I twist it? How can I get out of it? How can I make it something that is good for me or better than what it seems like it is at this very moment? And in this scripture, the Bible's encouraging us to not trust in your own understanding, but rather to trust in the Lord. And that I would trust in the Lord, because in John 16:33, he says, I've already overcome the world. See, the stuff that you're dealing with and you're trying to figure out is stuff that he's already aware of. He's not surprised by the circumstances on your job. He's not surprised that when you go home and you leave here, you go into just a hornet's nest of mess that you don't know how to deal with. He's not surprised that your kids are doing what they're doing and behaving how they're behaving. He's not even surprised about the stuff that you're doing that you don't want nobody to know about. And so since it is that he has already overcome this world and all this stuff that we can look at is involved in this world, what we really need to understand here is that we just need to trust in him. We need to acknowledge him in all of our ways, and in fact, he will indeed direct our paths. And so I thought, just from a practical application standpoint, we would go and look at Paul and Silas in the book of Acts. Because Paul and Silas have to walk through this very thing. They have to walk through some trouble in this world, and they only are able to do it by trusting and leaning on God. Amen? Amen. So Acts chapter 16 is, again, where we're going to spend the majority of our time this morning. Beginning at verse 16, I'm going to read. We'll just talk through this as we progress. Verse 16 says this: now it happened as we went to prayer that a certain slave girl possessed with the spirit of divination met us, who brought her masters much profit by fortune telling. Some good old Christian folk just going on their way to prayer. Not bothering nobody. Just trying to do the Lord's will, I'm sure. Amen? This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation. And this she did for many days. But Paul, greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out that very hour. Good Christian folk on their way to a good old church prayer meeting. Encounter a young lady possessed by some demon spirit. And after a few days, speak deliverance into her life. Ain't bothering nobody. Just doing the work of the Lord. Verse 19 says, but when her masters saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. And they brought them to the magistrates and said, "These men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe." Now, I want to pause there for just a second, because I think there's something important to note. Now, Paul and Titus have been traveling along, preaching the gospel, these customs that were not good for Romans to follow, for quite some time. And they didn't have any issue with nobody until they started messing with somebody's money. You see that, right? The Bible says that these men, they were using this woman who was possessed. They were using her to tell fortunes, and they were making a profit off of this spirit that was dwelling within this woman. And so the men that Paul and Silas brought deliverance unto this woman, difficulty begins knocking at their doorstep. Here's how that might translate to your life and to my life. Let's talk about being a new Christian first. Sometimes when you're a new Christian, you've been going along and life seemed like everything was okay, and you come to this understanding that you need God in your life. And so you give your life to the Lord, and you walk out of the church believing that everything is supposed to be A-okay from that day forward. And in the same way that Paul and Silas begin having trouble knocking on their door when they move in the power of God, the moment that you give your life to Him, boy, there just begins to be some turmoil and tornadoes that pop up out of nowhere. That's what it may look like for the new believer. Let's talk about the seasoned believer. You've made it through some storms and some difficulties, and you're trusting in God pretty good these days. And you find yourself dealing with some new circumstance or some new challenge, and rather than go to the default of how do I get myself out of this, you go to your knees in prayer and just beginning to call on God, asking for an answer and a solution. And it just seems like one isn't coming. And not only does it seem like one's not coming, that's when everybody just begins to get into your ear. "Well, girl, I would do this. Brother, I can't believe you didn't do such and such. You mean to say, what's going on?" And then we begin to become uneasy, unsettled. And we begin questioning whether we really ought to trust God with this thing, or if we should just take control ourselves and figure this thing out. Then maybe you've been called into ministry. So you were doing okay while you were just sitting on the pew. And then wasn't bothering nobody. Nobody was bothering you. You would come to church every Sunday. But God began speaking to your heart about getting involved. And so you raise your hand and you begin getting involved. And lo and behold, before you know it, it just seems like chaos has landed upon your life. The minute you decide to get involved with something, serving God. I think what the scripture suggests here is that if Paul and Silas hadn't cast the demon out of that young lady, the circumstances that we're about to read probably would have never fell upon them. Verse 22 says, "Then the multitudes rose up together against them." The multitudes. It wasn't just the one or two that threw them in the jail. Now they were able to get a whole mass of people. Mob of people. They were ministering without bothering anybody for a long time, and all of a sudden now the multitude is against them. And the magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. Have you ever just felt like, "God, I'm doing everything I know to do that's right"? And it just seems like my situation's getting worse and worse day by day. 23 says, "And when they laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks." Paul and Silas, outdoing the work of the Lord, preaching the good news, seeing folks healed and delivered, set free. Some churches haven't seen nobody healed. I'm sorry. Seeing folks healed and delivered and set free. And now they find themselves in the jail. Many of us are facing different circumstances and situations every day. And we find ourselves at the same point where I believe that we find Paul and Silas right now in this story, in this passage. I believe that Paul and Silas can respond in one of two ways. They can respond on the side of cursing God, because it's your fault we're here. You told us to go and preach this gospel. Why didn't you protect us? Why did we get beaten? Why are we sitting in jail? Or they can respond and say, God, I don't understand the circumstances, but I know you. I don't know why we're here right now. I don't know how we're going to get out of this, but God, I know you. And so all I can do is put my trust in you. You've been so good that I would be a fool to stop trusting you now. And so I'm going to stay right over here. See, some of us, we're in that place. And some of us are on this side over here, but we're screaming at God, why me? I did everything you wanted me to do, God. Why me? It's not fair that I'm being treated this way, God. Why me? And then we go through the list of things that we do and have done. I tithe every Sunday, every month. I go to church every Sunday. I read my Bible. And we go on and on and on. Let's see what Paul and Silas did. 25 says, but at midnight. See, midnight is that point of decision. Midnight is that crossroad. See, it's the exact moment that day crosses over into night, and night crosses over into day. See, something special can happen at midnight if we're positioned in the right way, in the right place. So the Bible says, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Say what? Say what? Praying and singing hymns to God? God is the reason I'm up in this jail right now. I got some words for him, but I don't know if they would be classified as prayers or hymns. I wonder what hymn they would be singing in jail at midnight. Be not dismayed, whatever betide. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Through every day along the way, he will take care of you. God will take care. Or maybe they were singing like we sang this morning, I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Lord, right now at midnight, every hour I need thee. Bless me right now, my Savior. I come to thee. I don't know what they were singing. But it strikes me that through all the pain, through all the difficulty, through the challenge of what they were facing, serving God and finding themselves being condemned in prison, having been beaten, that their first response is to praise and worship God, to continue to pray to him, to trust him in their circumstance, even though everything around them looks like he has already failed them. So my question is, in your midnight hour, what is your response? When it looks like God has not shown up, when it looks like God has fallen off the throne in your situation, when it looks like there is no answer for you to deal with the current circumstance, what is your response at midnight? Are you praying and praising, or are you cursing the Most High God? I believe that there's some answers found in prayer and praise. I believe that God can begin to move when we're praying and praising. The Bible goes on to say here that as they're praying and singing hymns to God, it says the prisoners were listening to them. Oh, wait a minute. So they've just been through hell. They've been beaten and scorned and all for naught, for no reason really. And you want me to be worried about somebody else who's watching me? See, Revelation 4:11 says this. It says that your life and my life is all about God's good pleasure. All throughout the Psalms, the Bible talks about God delivering for His name's sake. See, my life is not about me. My life is to glorify Him. And so there may be some circumstances, some situations where God can take my life and I go through some stuff. But through me going through the stuff that I'm going through, God is able to make some other stuff happen that God can be glorified.
Yes.
See, folk know that you go to church. Mm-hmm. Some folk may know what church you go to. You may even testify about how God has done some good stuff for you in the past. And so the minute that you are going through a situation, I want you to know all eyes are on you. Romans says it this way, the whole world is groaning and looking for an answer. Folks are watching you because you claim to be a Christ follower. Folks are looking to see how you respond. And 9 times out of 10, what they're finding when they're looking at us who claim to be Christ followers is that we don't respond any differently than they do. As they go through difficult circumstances, they don't have answers, and they fall out on the floor and they flop around, crying, screaming, and moaning. And they're watching you as you go through your little thing. And you've fallen out on the floor, flopping about, crying and moaning. But something was happening in this cell with Paul and Silas. They were in solitary confinement. They were in the inner cell inside the prison. And at midnight, at their point of decision, the crossroads between day and night, they began praising God about their lives, about how good God is. And the Bible says that the other prisoners around them heard them and were paying attention to what was happening in their cell. 26 says, suddenly, there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosened. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake and all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosened. See, here's the metaphor. In your life and in my life, we're surrounded by people who don't know Christ. We're surrounded by people who are in circumstances and situations that they do not have answers to. We're surrounded by people who need a Savior and may be looking for a Savior, but just haven't found anyone that can talk to them and get them to understand the Savior that we claim to believe in. And God is somehow able to use your midnight situation, the dark moments of your life that you don't really want nobody to know about. The difficult circumstance that almost took you, you almost gave up because of that thing. God is somehow able to take that very circumstance, that very situation, and minister deliverance unto people who are around you watching you. But not if I'm over here cursing Him and blaming Him for my circumstance. If I'm on the side of praising, lifting up, and acknowledging how good He is, even in the midst of, He's able to do some things. Goes on in verse 28 to say, but Paul called out with a loud, I'm sorry, 27. Says, the keeper of the prison, awakening from sleep, and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. See, sometimes when God begins to bless you, your enemy's not going to know what to do with himself. Now, if I could just be completely honest here for just a minute, and you all can pray for me after service, make a circle, come here, just pray, I can deliver. I'm just going to tell you that if it were Quentin and Silas, then the story would have read just a little bit different. If I was able to get myself to a point where I could praise God at midnight, then praise the Lord, I got to that point. But I'm just going to tell you right now, if it was Quentin in that prison cell and all the doors flung open and my chains were loose, the last thing I'm going to be worried about is a jailer who might commit suicide. Because I'm not supposed to be there, no way. I didn't do nothing to y'all. I was serving the Lord, and when the doors flew open, it was God setting me free. But Paul and Silas had a different vision of this thing.
Yes.
they understood and understand that their lives are about honoring God, their lives are about ministry, their lives are about seeing those who don't know Him come to know Him. And so when they saw this jailer drawing his sword to commit suicide, because he understood he was responsible for these prisoners. And if anyone was going to flee or to get loose on his watch, he would have been held accountable. He would have been killed himself by the officials of that day. And so Paul is not as concerned about his soul salvation. Says to him in a loud voice in verse 28, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light, he ran in and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. So now wait a minute. Do you see that? So the authority figure, the one who's in charge, controlling stuff. All this ruckus has gone on in the prison, and now he finds himself kneeling before Paul and Silas, trembling. I believe he was kind of confused. He didn't really understand what was going on. He probably understood that God was working in some kind of way, but just didn't have clarity as to what was going on. And I think he was so overwhelmed by this notion that they were all still there, his life would be spared, that all he could do was fall down and sort of yield himself to them. My question for us this morning is, when is the last time that in your midnight hour someone came to you, falling down in front of you, saying, "What can I do to be saved? How can I know you're God?" When you were going through at your job last go-round and you acted the way that you did, I don't know how you acted, but whatever way you acted, you did. And so did folks come running to you and say, "How can I serve your God?" after they saw your display? When the family had that problem last time and folk were fussing and arguing about what to do in this situation, and you did and said whatever you did and said. My question this morning is, what did folks say to you about your God when you were done? Did they say, I need to serve the God that you serve because your life is amazing to me? Or did they say, "How can she call herself a Christian?" There's more on the line. See, understanding your midnight means that you begin to understand that your midnight difficulty is not about you. See, this thing with Paul and Silas winding up in jail had nothing to do with Paul and Silas. They had done nothing wrong. There was no lesson for Paul and Silas to learn. They were simply thrown in jail for reasons beyond their control. And it's not until we get to the end of this story here that we really see what God was up to the entire time. Verse 30 again said, 29 again says, "Then he called for light and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas." 30 says, "And he brought them out and said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?'" Yes. You mean to tell me that Paul and Silas were arrested? They were beaten. They were thrown in solitary confinement, chained at their feet, like slaves or like dogs. All because John was looking to save a jailer. All because God was looking to save a jailer. Now, if you're in your flesh like I sometimes am, your fault might be, but God, all of that. I mean, you had some options, God. For real, they could have, you know, lashed me one less time with that whip. But then I'm called to wonder, what did God do to save me?
All right.
Whose life did he interrupt?
Yes.
Right.
Well, what were the circumstances that I'm still not even aware of that led to my salvation? Then I start thinking about this in a different way. Well, God, if you were going to take Paul and Silas, I mean, faithful men of God, Paul built this thing, a good portion of it in the New Testament, and they were faithful in preaching the word. God, if you would interrupt their lives in such a way to bring about salvation, I wonder what you did in my life. And more importantly, God, what can you now do through my life?
Yeah.
Lord, whose life can you impact like you impacted mine? Whose life can you change like you changed my life? God, what do you need to do that somebody might be saved because of my circumstance or my situation? And it begins to cause me to think differently about the stuff that I'm dealing with. Because I know that folk are watching to see how I'm going to respond. People are watching you. People know who you claim to be. They know who you claim to serve. And so they're looking at your responses to life to begin determining how they're going to respond to life. And the biggest impact that we can make on the world around, if we want to live in a better world, then we need to become better people. If we want to live in a better world, then we need to become better people. Because as we become better people, it begins to cause those who are watching us to wonder and to think and to question who they are and what they do. Who's watching you? Whose life are you changing for Christ by the way that you live? How are you making an impact on the people around you? If someone's looking in on your difficulty, can they still tell that you're a Christian? You begin to make sense of your midnight. It's important to understand a few things. The first is that your midnight may not be about you. I said that before, but just in closing, 3 points. The first is that your midnight may not be about you. Everything in your life is about God being glorified, God being lifted up, God being exalted. The second thing that you have to know is that your midnight difficulty is not a surprise to God. He's not surprised by what you're dealing with right now. Didn't catch him off guard. He wasn't unaware. He didn't wake up and go, oh, I forgot about her. He's not surprised by it. Here's the third and the most important thing. God can be glorified through your midnight difficulty. God can be glorified through your midnight difficulty. I'm not here this morning to tell you that it's easy all the time to trust God in our difficult situations. What I'm here to tell us this morning is that as people who call ourselves Christians or Christ followers, we have a responsibility to learn through difficulty after difficulty how to make trusting God become our default rather than our recent play. Here's what I mean when I say default versus our recent play. So your default means that that's just kind of what you do. Right? Some difficulty comes up, my default is I'm just going to trust God because that's what I know and that's how I respond. A reset play, which is maybe where some of us are today, means that when I face a difficulty, I start down this path of trying to understand it and fix it myself in my own way. And eventually I get to this place where I realize I really need to be over there trusting God. So I'm able to then kind of reset myself in my direction and get in the right path. It's okay if that's where you are today. But our prayer should be that as we're going through difficult situations and circumstances, that God would help us to understand and to see Him in the circumstance. As you're going through a difficult circumstance, our prayer needs to be, God, help me to see you in this circumstance. Because He's in it. He's with you in your circumstance. You may not sense where He is. You may not see Him right now. But you have to have the assurance that God is with you in the circumstance that you're dealing with. And as God reveals to you where He is in your situation, I believe that you'll have a peace that comes over you. I believe that you'll be able to deal with things that you never thought impossible to deal with, and you'll be okay. I believe that you'll be able to speak and to change other people's lives because they will have seen by your walk the God that you claim to serve. So I think we need to stop talking about our God so much and start living about our God.
Amen.
Start showing people who our God is by our actions, by the simple kindness that we have. You get some time. Matthew chapter 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Really, 5, 6, and 7. I just believe if every believer, I'm going to say my words carefully because, you know, people can take what you're saying. I'm not saying ignore the rest of the Bible. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying if you only could have 3 chapters in the book to read, to study, to live your life by, I believe that if we as Christians chose Matthew 5, 6, and 7, we would change this world. Just those 3 chapters, 5, 6, and 7. Jesus preaching the Sermon on the Mount. Very simple truths about how we ought to live. Most of them are contrary to popular thought. You steal something from me, I'm going to give you some more. You hit me on this side, I'm going to offer this side too. If we start living this thing that we say we believe, man, there's power. There's power in your walk. There's power in your talk. Lives will be changed and transformed. Is that all right this morning, church? I'm just kind of curious. Has anybody gone through a midnight hour? Or 1 or 2? And I want you to stand to your feet this morning. Oh, to Jesus I surrender. I surrender all.